If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order. Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this T4D where we're going to talk about kind of a mishmash of things. We're going to take it some of the new old equipment that I've got on my bench. We're going to talk about why I suddenly seem to be steering towards more vintage or older test equipment, and that wasn't a conscious decision. I'm going to show you and explain why. And then we're also going to take a look at a spectrometer that I've just purchased off eBay. It's the Ocean Optics USB 2000 Plus. And I'm going to be talking about its capabilities, why I've got it, because I've already got another spectrometer, and going into the calibration process. Right. So before we get into this, a warning, just because I know potentially that this video might draw other people who don't normally watch my channel because there's an unusual device I'm talking about. These videos are more unstructured, kind of more free talking, and if that kind of thing frustrates you, this might not be the video for you. So I just warn you up front. And then just let me give you a bit of background as to why I'm doing another T4D so soon. It wasn't my intention. I was hoping to do, I did mention I was going to do the video on explaining EL testing, electroluminescence testing, and how that's done and the results and how I photograph multiple solar panels. But I thought we'd take a quick break. And my intention was to do a video on an upgrade to my AC power source. I was going to do an upgrade and fix the noise problem that it had. So I discovered a fix after a lot of attempts and trying a lot of solutions, which would make it hopefully a more accurate device to use in terms of cutting off the current when you wanted to. But I needed to wait for another component to arrive, and that hasn't. So then I got stuck into playing with and attempting to use this Ocean Optics spectrometer, and discovered that it was way out of calibration, and I had a fair bit on my hands to get this back into calibration with a few challenges. And so I thought I'd show you that and also talk about some of the other tools that I've been using to look at the response, the spectral response of solar panels. I keep on talking about this and I've not really shown you what I've done, because some of the things I've done haven't worked out. But in this video, I'm going to kind of throw that all together. If I had to do individual videos on all these topics, I'd probably end up having to produce somewhere between 4 to 6 videos. So I'm going to try and combine it down. I say one video. This will probably be my first T4D that I break into two parts, because there's a fair bit to discover. And if you are a test equipment geek, you don't have to be interested in optical test equipment, which is again what I'm talking about. But if you're a test equipment geek, you might find it quite fascinating on how that device works and the calibration process. Right, so let me take you to my bench and show you some of the changes I've made on my bench in terms of the test equipment and why they have happened. So let me just give you a quick zoomed out view of my bench, and some of you with sharp eyes will realize perhaps some of the changes. This is the Fluke Auto Ranging Combi Scope. And just a quick bit of background, you'll remember that I used to have that Owen that odd little oscilloscope I bought, the square upright one, which allows you to do fairly quick measurements. If you just quickly want to see a signal, it's very analog-like, although it's digital, it's fast, and it allows you to acquire a signal quickly, but it obviously doesn't have a lot of functionality that you would have in a digital storage oscilloscope. But I still like the analog speed of a device like that, but it's missing some features. If I just want to power on a scope quickly and be able to quickly look at a signal, what this interesting scope does from Fluke. Now, I say from Fluke, I think it was originally developed by Philips and it's rebranded as Fluke. It is both an analog oscilloscope and a digital oscilloscope. There's a button you push on there, I'll bring you in a little closer, that switches between those two modes. Still on a CRT, but it is both analog and digital. So if you want to switch between modes because you either want the speed or you want digital capability, you can do that on that scope. The other is a very analog-like signal and pulse generator from HP. We'll take a closer look at that. You already know, or you've probably seen the HP RMS voltmeter. And then I'll be talking more about the Simpson microammeter. And that's got to do with my project. We're trying to look at the spectral sensitivity of solar panels. And then you'll note there's a gap over here. I had a CORAD power supply, which used to frustrate me, the interface. Again, that's a project. I've got other power supplies here. So I pulled that out. I've got one of those Ryden, the kind of Chinese DC to DC converters where you put in a power supply and you use the DC to DC converter and use it as a power supply. And I must say, I'm really impressed with the functionality that you get out of that. So more about that in another video. But I found I had actually forgotten I had that Unity UT803 bench multimeter. And I don't have a bench multimeter that I can just switch on quickly because obviously my 3458A tucked away there is not something you just switch on quickly and take a quick measurement. And sometimes I just don't want the bench cluttered with a handheld multimeter. And I sold my Regal and my Fluke bench multimeter before I left Ohio. Some regrets about that. I say it's a problem when you sell certain test equipment there, certain situations you go, oh, I really need it. This multimeter is really lousy. I just put it here yesterday as a temporary measure. I'm getting a more older vintage HP bench multimeter. Again, just so it's easy to switch on and use. But let's come in a little closer. And again, I'll explain the reasons for going with the older equipment. Right, so let's first start off with the Simpson multi-range DC microammeter. I basically needed to measure microamps when shining a certain light on a solar panel. So in terms of the looking at the spectral response, you'll see more of the other equipment later. I have calibrated LED light sources which I can potentially shine onto a solar panel to try and work out the spectral response, and I need to measure the current. And the current is in the range of microamps, and doing that on a traditional multimeter is sometimes not the easiest. I don't want to see digits going back and forth. I want to see a nice analog response. Trying to find a modern day microammeter is a challenge for one. They're just not commonly made, and often the ones you get aren't very well made. This one, I think, I can't remember whether I bought off eBay or Amazon. It's fairly good. It gives a range of 0 to 50, but that's not enough range, and I wanted a larger sweep, and you just don't find that even in modern analog meters. So I was fortunate to find the Simpson meter. As you can see, you've got a nice large sweep, which means you get nice resolution on the dial. You've got a mirror across there to help you with parallax issues, and you've got multiple ranges, which can be really handy because if you've got a solar panel or something which is more sensitive, the 75 microammeter range might be too small, and you can then step it up to 150, 300, 750, and 1500. So 1.5 milliamps is what it goes to. So again, this is where just some of that old test equipment fulfills a need at a reasonable price. And that's a problem I'm finding, particularly when it comes to optical test equipment. And you're going to see when we get down to the calibration side at my desk, I have another old piece of test equipment to supply a light source. And that's the other challenge with this project. I need to shine a light at a solar panel and go through the spectrum I don't necessarily need a fine resolution light, even if I have broad bands of light, like shining individual LEDs. But if you do want to kind of go through the spectrum and know what wavelength you're shining at the solar panel, those light sources, if you buy a contemporary one, a modern day one, they are in the thousands of dollars. So I found a way of being able to do this with some old test equipment, which I'll explain once we get down to my PC, which is where we're going to look at more of this equipment. So here's a closer look at this Fluke. This one, I bought kind of the entry level bottom of the range ones. So you get ones which obviously you get ones which do bigger bandwidth and have got a higher sampling rate for the digital side of them, but I just wanted to make sure that this fitted my need. It was at a good price and in good condition, because often many of these, the way these were constructed, if these weren't handled carefully, if they took a knock to the front, they would crack the face or the back would be cracked. So many of these on eBay I found were damaged, and this one I found in particularly good condition. But as you can see, it's got all the controls on here. My only gripe about the scope, and I say I haven't had a long time with it, is that I wish the controls for setting the amplitude and the time base were still analog dials. Even if they were digitally, even if they had a digital back end to them, I just wish I had a knob or a dial to turn rather than pushing buttons. But nonetheless, it's got the, I say, it's got the functionality of a normal CRT with a normal analog trace, but you've got this yellow or orange button over here. You can see it says analog on the top, and you switch that, and you literally switch between modes, going from an analog scope to a digital scope, where you can obviously do run stop, you can set triggers and captures and all that kind of thing, but still revert to the functionality of analog when you need it, if you need a good acquisition of a tricky signal. So I say, potentially in the future, that's something else we can review, but it's just something say, which I find really handy. You know, you power it on, you're not waiting for a computer to boot up, it's on and it's running. And that then leads us then into this HP pulse function generator, which can go up to 20 megahertz. The HP RMS voltmeter that I did a review on, and I talked about the calibration. I still want to do a video where I go through the calibration process, because it's quite interesting seeing the insides and how you calibrate it. And as I mentioned, I had to use a multitude of signal generators. In fact, I resorted to three separate signal generators, my TTI being one, my big clumpy HP, which is on the side, and then a Tektronix audio device which could supply signals. And I realized the shortcomings of each of those pieces of equipment, but this lovely older analog style function generator provides all the functionality I need to calibrate that device in a very simple, quick to boot up device. And one of the key strengths of this device is that it can produce very small amplitude, very small signals, which is what you need if you're trying to calibrate that RMS meter that I've got. But besides that, it just boots up quickly and is easy to use. And I'm going to give you a quick demonstration with my TTI. Now, what I'm about to demonstrate is certainly not really a poke at the TTI. I am a huge fan of AIM TTI equipment, particularly their function generators and also their power supplies. And I love this device, except if I just want to quickly power on and inject a test signal into something, I'll just show you. So as I power this on, it's on. So we wait. It's busy booting up. It says, please wait. Still waiting. Get the intro screen. Bang. Now it's ready. Okay. But of course, if I want a signal, I've got to push buttons, perhaps type in a frequency and what have you. Now, this does give me a fair bit of precision and resolution that I can adjust to, and it's fantastic for that. But you're waiting for a computer to boot up, and then adjusting and pushing knobs to get where you want to be. Or I say pushing knobs, you're mainly pushing buttons. And that as an interface sometimes really annoys me. So look here,
I'm going to push on the power button. Bang, it's on and it's already got an output. And if I want to make adjustments, I just push a button to select the type of wave. I'm not going into menus. And then all I'm doing is I'm turning these knobs to adjust the amplitude, duty cycle, frequency. And it's very easy to flick that button, make adjustments, go to various ranges if you need to, if you need to attenuate the signal. And that's what I love about this. And I've had a few pieces of test equipment. One was a Signant Bench multimeter, and two, a Keysight or Agilent oscilloscope, which I actually really liked. And when I came to use them, I had these stored away, and I pulled one out and I powered it up, and it hung. It hung on a boot up screen because there's a computer inside. And I can say the same. I've got a TTI power supply, which I bought off eBay for half the price of what it retails for. It's a very functional, flexible power supply. But occasionally, it hangs when you boot it up because there's this computer inside. So I am starting to steer towards kind of older vintage analog equipment. Not all analog equipment, but I'm finding that a lot of the older test equipment can be easy, fairly reliable, as long as you don't have any inherent issues with capacitors or what have you inside. Perhaps easier to service and maintain because of the type of electronics inside. And they can provide you with either measurement capability or source a signal or voltage or what have you at levels which you'd pay a lot of money if you're going to try and buy contemporary equipment to do that. And I've just realized that suddenly I'm starting to trend towards a lot of old equipment for that reason. Right then, so now let's start looking at some of the optical experiments I've been doing. Right then, so let's have a chat about my kind of interest or research into the spectral response of solar panels. And I realize this is fairly niche and it's getting down to a level which I'm sure a lot of people aren't interested in, but it's just something that's really caught my interest, is with how light interacts with certain substances, and in particular the photoelectric effect. One of the things which led me to this was actually certainly Sean in South Africa, when he mentioned to me the photoelectric effect you could get from an LED, a light emitting diode, if you pass light into it, that it would generate a current. I hadn't realized that. And that led on to a whole lot of other interesting projects and things that I tried. My solar panel test bed, you need to understand the light spectrum from the sun and trying to recreate that. And then that led to this, was trying to understand and realizing that different types of solar panels respond to different parts of the spectrum of the sun. And I just wanted a tool to tell me which solar panels respond to what part of the spectrum. How could that be useful? I've said this before, you may have an application where you have a device that you want to have working indoors under artificial light. A classic example of that is perhaps, let's say, a solar-powered wristwatch, although obviously you might be outdoors and it gets sun from outside. If you have a solar-powered desktop calculator, if you used a traditional solar panel, which is looking for, which has its peak response in the infrared range, that's not going to be very useful indoors. The light indoors is very different. We've got incandescent light and more LED light. So you're looking more into the visible part of the spectrum, into the greens and blues and UV part of the spectrum. And there, amorphous solar panels have got a better response. So understanding or being able to tell where a solar panel is more responsive to various parts of the spectrum can be very useful. I'm just doing this more out of interest and intrigue rather than an actual application. So how have I gone about trying to do that? And certainly I've been trying to do this on the cheap, because once you start getting into optical test equipment, so I'm talking about test equipment or devices that can either source light or measure light, they start getting very expensive. A lot of that equipment is more specialized. It's used in labs and by scientists, and so it's more difficult to get hold of and expensive. So I've tried to do things through some experimentation on the cheap. Some of that has worked, some of it hasn't. But let me explain what I've been trying to do and how I've gone about it. If you want to understand the spectral response of a solar panel, the one way to do it is to shine, let's say, have a light source where you can sweep right through the spectrum. And then what you do is you measure the output, you measure the current that's generated as you're sweeping that light source across the solar panel. So you go, let's say, from the UV part of the spectrum, you'd sweep through blue, green, yellow, orange, red, infrared, and you'd see at what part of the spectrum you're generating the most current. And then that would lead you to the, and then that would give, certainly give you a good indication as to where the solar panel is the most sensitive. The one challenge with that is, for one, finding a light source which allows you to do that kind of sweep. And one of the bigger challenges still is having a consistent intensity. So a solar panel is going to generate its electricity because you've got photons of light coming from the sun. And each of those photons has the potential to knock an electron out of its normal orbit and send that electron to do some work as electricity. Now, that's an oversimplified explanation. I do have a video where I talk about the photoelectric effect, but that's what's happening. You've got these light photons coming in, and light photons at the various bandwidths have different energy levels. So photons coming in the UV part of the spectrum have far more energy than photons coming in the infrared part of the spectrum. And that's why UV has the ability to penetrate our skin, our dermis, and knock out and damage skin cells, and thus causing skin cancer. And that's because UV has so much energy. So the one key part, if you are shining a light across the solar panel and seeing where it's most sensitive, you need to keep that light intensity, in other words, the number of photons, the same across the light source. So either your single light source, which you're moving through the spectrum, has to be adjusted as it moves through it, or if you're using different light sources, like the approach I'm taking with using multiple different LEDs, you have to calibrate these so that the light intensity or brightness is the same. And that's really tricky. I initially thought I could take a meter, like I've got my spectrometer over here. It has a lux meter. You can measure lux. Now there's, and again, I'm certainly not an expert in this area, and I've also been caught out by misunderstanding a certain terminology. Often with a flashlight or a torch, they all sell it, and the big selling point is the number of lumens that it gives out. They'll say, this torch is really bright. It gives out 5,000 lumens. But a lumen isn't a measure of brightness. It's a measure of the volume of light. So you can have two different light sources. I could have one that gives out 1,000 lumens, and I could give another, and I could have another device which gives out 200 lumens, and yet the device which is giving out 200 lumens seems brighter to me. And that's because if you have a device which is giving out that volume of light through 360 degrees, 1,000 lumens through a complete 360 degree arc, let's say like a camping lamp, and then I've got a flashlight which only produces 200 lumens, but it's in a concentrated beam, just a narrow beam out this way, that is actually going to be brighter than what you perceive from the other device. So lumens is a measure of the volume or amount of light, and lux is more a measure of the brightness. But the problem with lux, and this device, the spectrometer, does measure lux, and I thought, oh, well, it's a spectrometer. It's kind of catering for the different parts of the spectral band, if you will. So it'll take that into account. But lux is particularly weighted or calibrated to the spectral response or our eye's sensitivity to light. And our eyes, like solar panels, have a certain spectral response. And our eyes are most sensitive to the kind of green wavelengths. So we'll perceive green. If you had the same brightness, the same number of photons coming from a green light and a red light, we'd perceive the green light to be brighter because our eyes are more sensitive in that area. And so using lux as a measurement is, of course, doesn't work for you because it's weighted differently. It's not measuring intensity of the photons, it's measuring our eyes perception. And of course, that's useful in the real world because that's how we judge brightness, is with our eyes. But at a scientific or quantum level, you want to look at the number of photons. And so in order to do that, that's where I purchased this device from Apogee. And this measures photons across a broad bandwidth of light. Now, forget, does it? Yeah, so it mentions this measures from 340, so that's in the UV part of the spectrum, up to 1040 nanometers. But that's a fairly broad band of light to cover just with a single sensor. And that's the challenge with devices like that. But what they do with this device is they will shine, or they will sweep a spectrum of light across the sensor, and they will have a calibrated device which is set at the same brightness across the spectrum, and then they will use algorithms with this one sensor to give you a reading of the number of photons. Now, this device doesn't measure or give you a reading in the photon count, because you'd have in the range or brightness or intensity that you're measuring in, you're going to have millions or billions of photons, and it's very difficult for one to display those kinds of numbers on this kind of device. Also, if you had those huge numbers and you could display it, it's not easy to interpret if you're glancing at various readings and you've got, let's say, a scientific number to the power of 10 of something. So they use a convenient measurement used for in chemistry and science is the mole. And I'll put up on the screen how much a mole is, but it helps if you're looking at something like molecules or atoms or photons, where it's a large number. So you group a large number of those, a mole of those, into one unit. So one mole describes a lot of electrons or a lot of atoms or a lot of photons. And this device in particular measures in micromole per square meter per second. So it's an amount over a certain area per second. And that's how this does its measurement. But at least this, rather than a lux meter, is looking at photons. And from this, I can then measure photons. And then what I've done is I use the spectrometer over here, and I've got a group of LEDs spanning across the spectrum. So of course, doing the measurement this way means I cannot go to down to a very fine resolution. I'm just looking at certain bands in the spectrum that potentially a solar panel is sensitive to. So if you look here, you can see I've got there 940 nanometers. So that's infrared. This one's 519 nanometers green, 654 nanometers red, 442 nanometers, that's blue, and then I've got another infrared at 850 nanometers. So how do I know how many nanometers these are? Because these are cheap LEDs that I've just bought off Amazon or wherever. I've got a spectrometer. And I've had this, I'm not sure how to pronounce it. Is it UPR Tech spectrometer? I've had this for a while. You'll have seen where I've used this to measure, look at the sun and set up my solar table. I'll just power it on quickly just to give you a quick demonstration. I don't think I've ever actually reviewed this device, but it's been heavens. I would have been stuck doing the experiments I have been unless I had this kind of device. But it boots up. It'll first ask you if you want to do a dark calibration. So it's got a little cover over here. You put it over the aperture where the light is. There's a sensor over here. And you do a dark calibration to, for one, understand the noise levels. One of the one challenge with measuring light is your signal to noise ratio. So you can do this, you take a dark measurement, and from there you can then go and take your other measurements. So in this case, I'm just going to say no. It's got a nice touch screen, and on here you can do various measurements to various standards. If you're trying to understand colors, the colors of light, the spectrum of where light is coming from, and then also, let's say, if you just want a basic wavelength and the lux measurement, it can do that as well. But the one I use most is the spectrum. So if we go into the spectrum, if I just click this right now, there's a little trigger on the side here to activate the sensor and take a measurement. If I just push that, bang, you can see it gives a really nice colorful display of the spectrum that it's seeing. And because I've got LED lights, you can see we've got a nice swath across the visible part of the spectrum. You can see kind of from the high 400s up to about 760 nanometers, right across the visible part of the spectrum. And then look at this spike. This is a blue spike, and that's typical of LED lights. And I say, unless you have a tool like this, trying to get a setup to test solar panels, for instance, would be impossible, because you need to be able to measure what part of the spectrum lights are putting out, so you can balance that to get the to as best match the what the spectrum out of the outdoor sun is doing. So this has been a really handy tool, and you can see over there it's showing you the integration time. So the integration time is the amount of time that the sensor is collecting light for, and that is going to be of more interest when we get to this device over here at my computer. And I talk about how it works, and obviously integration time is important because you need to have the sensor switched on long enough collecting light to be able to see light. But if you have it on for too long, it'll saturate. It'll reach the point where it's saturated. It's got too much signal, too much light to measure, basically. So this device, you do have some control over that measurement, but you can measure from a few milliseconds, I think it's 1 millisecond, up to 1,000, so only up to 1 second. Whereas this device, you can measure up to 1 minute, in fact, many minutes. But when you start measuring many minutes with this device, you then start getting to issues with that your signal to noise ratio, where temperature, for instance, one addition that you can have on this device is a thermal cooler. So you can have a piezoelectric cooler. You can thermally cool this, because heat is the enemy of certainly of the electronics and the sensor when you're trying to measure light. So what I would do is basically get the LEDs, I'd put them on the front here, I'd block out. Sometimes you don't have to worry about too much light leakage when you've got a fairly intense LED up against this. I can put it on there, and then I can obviously read straight off what part of the spectrum it's at. I'll do a quick demonstration. Right, so I've just gone and switched off my bench lights just to avoid some of the reflection. You see, this does pick up the reflection depending on what angle I'm using. The other tool, which has been invaluable, has been Ian Johnston's little voltage standard. So you can use this as a calibration device for multimeters. You can obviously set various voltages. I've shown this in another video. But it's also a very precise voltage source. And I found for this project, having the level of resolution, being able to set voltage down to, well, you can see I can set down to 5 digits. I've certainly had to set down to the individual millivolts. And this device allows me to do that and to repeat that accurately. And that's the important thing here. I need the resolution and the accuracy if I'm going to obtain the correct brightness or the number of photons coming from this LED. Now, bear in mind, this all sounds very scientific, but any scientist looking at the setup will be cringing, because there are so many things that can go wrong. As I said, I've just been trying to do something on the cheap, because to get a light source to be able to do what I'm doing here will cost thousands of dollars. And obviously this silly little setup where I've gone and modified these little flashlights with my own LEDs costs, literally this setup probably cost me about $25 to do this. But anyway, so what I do, I've got them in this flashlight. I'll explain the logic behind why I've got them in the flashlight. I put them in front of my spectrometer. I then take a measurement. I click that, bang. There you can see we've got a nice peak. And now let's see how far off I am. So that is measuring. It says that that green LED is at 520 nanometers. What have I got noted on here? I've said this is at 519. A difference of 1 nanometer in wavelength for the broad range that I'm measuring to isn't a problem at all, because I'm using a very coarse resolution on the wavelength for this test. My most critical measurement is actually the light intensity. But what can upset that reading? Just the simple voltage level that goes into here, besides the voltage level which is going to set the brightness or the number of photons coming from this LED, that can also change the wavelength of the light. If I had to change this up or down, you would actually see how that wavelength differs. So that's the one reason for having being able to set this and calibrate it. But of course, the other is for the brightness. So that's where this, I say, this spectrometer has been really useful. I can set this device to also do kind of constant readings. If I just switch the click on the little iris over there, you'll see there's some arrows which are going round. And now if I push the shutter or the activation, it'll constantly take snapshot measurements according to the integration time. Now, because the light is fairly low going into the sensor, you can see it's up the integration time to 1,000 milliseconds or 1 second. If I place this down in front of the LED, it's going to adjust that. And in fact, if you have a look, it has adjusted that down to 17 milliseconds. So it obviously needs far less time for that measurement so that it doesn't saturate the actual sensor. But I say, this is where this tool has been very useful. So if I just click that, the other measurement I was talking about on this, I'll just switch off the automatic or go home. If I go to the basic measurement, here you can get the color temperature of the light, which can be really handy. CRI, to see the color rendering index of light, can be really handy. Let's say for videoing, I want a really high color rendering index, because the higher your CRI, the more natural looking colors are. It's in reference to like what something would look like in sunlight versus artificial light. So that's handy for that. There's that lux measurement I was talking about. I thought I could use to measure the brightness of LEDs, but of course that is weighted or calibrated to the human eye, not the number of photons. And then over here as well, it'll show you the wavelength that you're measuring at. So a very nice measurement tool. So that is this spectrometer. But I say the limitations are, you'll have seen that it can only measure, and let me just double quick, from 360 nanometers up to 760. If I'm working with solar panels, that's not enough. Whereas this device, you can see, goes all the way down to 341. It's not a huge difference down, but on the top end going into infrared, this can go to 1026 nanometers, which makes this, I say, gives it better capability, but also the biggest, one of the biggest things is integration time. As you realized from my last video, where I realized that I could change the way I was trying to do this experiment, as opposed to injecting light into a solar panel, is to inject a current into the solar panel, like I was doing for the electroluminescence testing, and have the solar panel radiate light, even though you can't see it, but I know it's a very low level. So you're getting down to the very low level of photons, and having something where I can increase the integration time, in other words, like the time the shutter is open, I can potentially collect more light. But there's a challenge there, which I'll talk about when we get to the kind of explanation of how this works and the calibration. Right, so going back to this experiment. So that is how I worked out what wavelength each of these LEDs were, and I labeled them. And then I went and used the Apogee device to measure the brightness. So what do I then do? I take this and I need to measure the light intensity. But of course here, I'm fraught with a whole lot of issues which are going to cause an error. The one is the lens on an LED is, for one, they're not all uniform and their focal point can be quite interesting. It's not uniform. So if I shine this LED on the bench there, for one, you can see you've got like a really intense bright spot in the middle and it changes as you go out. And for instance, you've got this ring around the outside and then this less intense piece in the middle. So if you have any slight movement on the LED when you're shining it on a solar panel, that is going to mess up your reading because your intensity is going to change. And you then, and this is the issue I faced, is you then within the margin of error of not knowing whether you're, because you've got only a small measurement range, and if you're slightly off on the intensity of the light or the placement of the light, that can mess everything up. So what did I do to try and help with that? For one, I placed the LEDs in these little flashlights. That meant they were held steady. These have got a flat surface. So if I put that on top of the solar panel to do a measurement, it means they're held off at exactly the same, or not exactly the same distance, but they at least, the distance is maintained. It's a steady distance once I've got it on the actual solar panel itself. But before we get there, I need to measure the brightness or the number of photons. So to do that, I've got an issue where if I've got this on top of the sensor, it can move around and mess things up. So if I switched this on, my goal with these was to be around within about 80, somewhere between 80 and 85 micromoles on this measurement device. But if I move this around, you can see the difference in the light reading. So as I move it there, you can see we're going down, dipping down into the 70s and up to 82. So that is fraught with issues as well. So I just, I literally rolled up a toilet roll. I covered it in some tape and spliced a hole in the top. And basically by having that, slipping it over there and then slipping the flashlight in there, that more or less holds the flashlight in the center of the sensor. I still need to be careful, and it also blocks other light leakage. I would still also cover this. I had a little black cloth which I put on here, and I just steadily move this to make sure that I've got it to the central point. So as you can see, even though it's held in place, the measurement can still be messed around, but it's far better than me without it being held at least roughly in the center. So by doing that, I can then use this device, and by literally even changing, so on this one, you can see I've got a lot of resolution if I'm changing the millivoltage down to the millivolts going to the LED. In some cases, I didn't have to. In this one, if I go down to the second decimal place and I start changing, you'll see how the light intensity is changing. So what I did with each of these LEDs, I set them up on a setup like this, got it centered as best as I can, and I aimed to get a reading, let's switch that back on again, of around 80. Generally speaking, my readings range between, I'd say, 80 and 83. But that's how I set the intensity level of each of these LEDs, by, say, using Ian Johnston's very nice voltage source, which gives me that resolution and precision. Because remember, although I've set it here, when I do this testing, I need to switch on a voltage source and deliver exactly that same voltage again in order to get the correct intensity. And again, this is fraught with things that go wrong. The length of the wires going to the LED can cause an issue, as say the positioning of the LED. There is so much that can go wrong, but I just tried to do something on the cheap. So this was my methodology, and I say I went through all these LEDs, noting their wavelength and then noting the voltage level that I'd need to run them at in order to get that light intensity. Right then, so what was the next step? And again, apologies for the lighting. If I have my bench lights on, it'll obviously mess up this experiment. And I can't realistically demonstrate exactly how this works because I'd need to create a dark environment because, of course, any light leakage would affect the outcome or the readings on the meter. So the one challenge again, and the reason I went to these little flashlights is that if I held an LED on the panel, because of the lens, depending on the orientation, that would mess up the number of photons which are hitting the particular target. So having these little flashlights was really handy. I could put them on there flat and they're always in the same orientation. The other challenge, which I accounted for, but I hadn't realized how important this was the positioning or location of where I was going to do the measurement. I realized that if I had this flashlight or this light source and I didn't place it in the same position, i.e. let's say I put it slightly over this edge, that would of course affect the reading on the meter. So I needed to be very sure that I had it in the same position. The other reason, and this is where the electroluminescence has highlighted the other issue, I could say, well, okay, as long as I've got it in this part of the solar panel, right, I'm on the same strip, it shouldn't be an issue as long as I don't cross over here where I've got this line where there is no silicon. But of course, now that I've been able to see the flaws on solar panels, you realize that the location is critical. For one, you can have some micro cracks which affect how well this part of the solar panel is working over here. And even if you don't have any damage or micro cracks on the solar panel, just the uniformity of the silicon as it's grown or developed, the uniformity is different right across the solar panel. Your readings or the electricity that's going to be generated in this position versus this position can certainly be different and will certainly affect the results that I see on the meter. So that's something I need to cater for. So what I did, I didn't get a little cloth rag as I'm doing at the moment, this little lens cleaning rag. I actually covered the complete panel in Gorilla Tape. And then what I did was I got one piece of Gorilla Tape with a hole, which was the same size as the flashlight was, the head of the flashlight, and I stuck that on the solar panel in a certain position so that I knew I was always going back to exactly the same test position. So the rest of the solar panel was covered up. Now, of course, in this case, that isn't. I'm just doing a quick rough demonstration. But the rest of the solar panel was covered up. And I'll just add a piece of tape just to do that, so I'd have just that exposed. If I had to lift this cloth at the moment, you'll see the meter is stirring. I then obviously need to set to the level that is going to be responsive to the LED. So I toss that over there. I then go and set the calibration level for the particular LED that I'm using. In this case, it's 2.49 volts. And then I go and place that over that target area. And then I get a reading on the microammeter of the number of microamps which are coming out of the solar panel from that. And then what I would do, I'd obviously do this with all of the LEDs and then carefully note the reading on the meter. But of course, this little experiment is fraught with little potential issues that can change that reading. I say a little slight movement. In some cases, you can see even with a little bit of error here, I'm lifting this up, the needle isn't swinging too much. So it shows there's a little room for maneuver over here. But any issues with setting the calibration of the brightness of the light, also the fact that the spectral response might be fairly flat over here. So you're not going to see a huge difference when you interchange the different LEDs. And that was the issue that I was having. There was certainly, I could see a change in the level of the current coming out of the solar panel when I changed the various LEDs. But that change was very small, and I realized that I was within a margin of error where it could be the positioning or the voltage setting. So I couldn't use it as a definitive test to tell me which part of the spectrum the solar panel was more responsive to. So in the end, this method of doing this testing hasn't really worked out. So that's where we move over to using electroluminescence, and that brought in the new spectrometer, which I'll show you at my bench, and that we'll do in part two.